this party with your host, Shawn Pelton.
Hey, what's happening? What's happening? Really honored to be here on the playlist party, and looking forward to trying to dive into some stuff that was had a big influence on me coming up and being able to survive in New York as a freelance drummer. I wanted to start back in like 82 and 83. I had the great fortune to study with Alan Dawson. And, you know, I was going to school and doing the jazz thing. And I was so into like Tony Williams and all the great jazz players, Roy Haynes, Billy Higgins, you know, all the Elvin, Art Blakey. So it was like, oh my God, I get to stay with Alan Dawson. And I remember going and saying, hey man, how did Tony do like, you know, in the Miles Live stuff, like Four and More, and, you know, and he said, listen, I think we need to take a deep breath and, you know, talk about the other side of that, which is like sort of the hypnotic thing of playing a groove that is maybe linear and static and from beginning to end and just making it feel amazing. And so the first thing that kind of led to was a Poinciana, that classic recording of Vernell Fournier with Homage Mall. So I just want to play a little bit of this feel, which is just, it's such a great groove. So Matt, you know, it was an interesting window into like this transition from sort of the deep dive of the jazz world into sort of the deep dive of parts and making records and stuff like that. And at the same time, I was really lucky, was going to school in Bloomington, Indiana, to be exposed to Kenny Aronoff. And it was right when Kenny was getting going when with John Mellencamp, and they were having all these hits, and it was on MTV, and it was so exciting. And I was so fortunate that he let me study with him and hang out. And man, that was another crucial element about learning the skills that it takes to sort of survive in the studio and coming up with parts and a sound and stuff like that. So Poinciana was an interesting window into this idea of committing to a groove and just trying to make it feel as great as possible. And I guess Vernell Fournier, that part, I was reading about it, it's sort of the inspiration is the New Orleans bass drum thing where the right hand, but and then the left hand is that offbeat on the hi-hat, which is sort of like the cymbal that's mounted on the bass drum, and I guess like sometimes played with a coat hanger or something like that. So it's interesting to hear about the inspiration of that part. And when I was going on Spotify and checking out all the different versions, there was one version that really caught my ear too, from the standpoint of the other part of this equation as far as surviving in the studio when I started working was just sonically how you set the stage for a track. So in the context of Poinciana, like when I was listening, this is Jeff Hamilton's version of it. And I love the ride cymbal sound and kind of the ambience that he's creating. Now when they go to the melody, he's gonna switch cymbal sounds. So all of a sudden, like the sonic, you know, stance of the recording changes, different cymbal sound, and like from this sort of washy, really cool, foggy, ambient, beautiful groove tightens up a little bit for the A section of the melody, you know. And all this started to kind of make sense, the mixture of like the jazz influence of that with sort of the straight ahead, like Mellencamp thing that Kenny was dealing with and watching him play, which was, you know, a totally another planet, you know, playing wise in the jazz world. And, you know, Keltner was a great big influence in the way that he would choose sounds and cast a spell sort of sonically in tracks. And maybe it wasn't so much technically about what was going on, but the choices made sort of sonically and part wise that would set a tune up and how they would release different parts of the kit, you know, like when to go to the ride cymbal or never go to the ride cymbal or floor tom for a bridge or not, or the way they would use color of the kit. The other thing that I remember reading a Keltner interview that really influenced me was this idea of like sort of diving into programming and having an open mind to understanding what that was about and how that could lead to some opportunities beyond just the playing thing. So there's this really cool version of Poinciana by Wolfpack, which, you know, such a cool group of musicians, but a programmed approach. Your breath is beating me along. So sort of kind of the, you know, the same part and same rhythm, but then cast totally different sonically, you know. And it's just interesting how this kind of shines a light on the choices that one deals with when they get handed a song and are asked to come up with a part and how to approach it. You know, like what is there a basic rhythm? Does it change in the chorus or it stays the same way all the way through, or it's orchestrated differently, you know, every section and the color choices that you make, or you mixing programming with the playing. So, I love that song as kind of an interesting example of some of that. And the Wolfpack thing, sort of, you know, the programming leads into this world of like great R&B field drummers that have been sampled through the years too, you know. And one of my favorite examples of that is Zigaboo from the Meters, you know, great groove player, amazing drummer. And there's a track, Old Calcutta, from this record, Look a Pie Pie, that this was like December of 69, I think. So I'm gonna just go to about a minute 40 into the track, and I'll play about four bars that leads into this middle breakdown thing. And the drum breakdown in the middle ends up getting sampled. We're gonna show in a second, but here's the this middle breakdown real quick, and let's just listen to these four bars. And in this four bar sequence, it's actually bars one and bar four that end up getting chopped into this thing we're gonna listen to. So okay, here's the whole original recording with the four bars. Okay, so I love it. We're gonna try some wizardry here and try to share the screen of this Ableton session. Now, here is a track that, a song called One Thing by an artist, Amory. And this was back in 2005. And I think it went all the way to number 8 in the charts. And it takes this Zigaboo phrase and uses it. So here's how it sounds. So it's like a four bar phrase that they've taken from Zigaboo's drums. So this next little part of the screen is like, this is the yellow is the one bar phrase over and over. And then this red one is the fourth bar. And so it's kind of like a deconstructed look at how they put this together. I love it. So then if you just take her vocal, for instance, here's her vocal by herself, an acapella of the vocal. Oh, I'm trying to let it go, trying to keep my eyes closed, trying to keep it just like before. Times when I never even thought to speak. Don't want to say what it is, but wait, it felt so serious. Every day is just too much. I want to shut it up, but it's this one thing that got me. Anyway, so I just love the idea of taking some of the greatest grooves that were ever laid down, and then the way they're sort of recycled creatively is amazing, you know. And it made me sort of appreciate sometimes just the sitting on a beat or a groove and being all in on, well, what is making this feel so good? And why does it feel so good? And the fact that maybe there isn't a fill every four bars means that there's tension that's building and stuff like that. So that makes me want to move on to another example of this, which is a great R&B drummer, session cat, that doesn't get talked about enough. His name is Ed Green. And wait, before we move though, is there that photo of Zigaboo? Oh yeah, that was a great moment backstage when Zig came and played in town, and then Will Calhoun, we were all hanging out, and that was a fun night. Man, Zigaboo is a really nice cat. One, and just huge, hugely influential on so many of us, you know. So this next example is Ed Green. So Ed Green was amazing drummer, played on a lot of the Barry White stuff, and Sarah Smile by Hall and Oates. He's on like the SWAT theme. It's interesting, like his discography is really wide ranging, which I love to see, because, you know, if you're working as a session player, and if you're just answering the phone and going, you know, trying to survive and pay the rent and stuff, it's not like you can choose, you know, who exactly you want to work for and stuff. And so it's so fascinating to see how wide of a range that stuff that he did. So this is a classic track of Ed's that I'm Gonna Love You Just a Little Bit More, Baby, by Barry White. I could sit and listen to that thing all day. And it's just such a great example of someone committing to a beat and just making the walls sweat, you know. And he's on so many great tracks, Donald Byrd, Bobby Bland, the SWAT theme, you know. We have to get all the way to, like, I think I want to just go to the first fill that happens. And it's like a minute and 24 into the track, so check it out. And it just feels so great. It's just so beautiful, you know, and it's wild. Like, the content of it is not mind-blowing, but the feel of it and sort of the dynamics and when he chooses it to make it happen. So let's listen one more time. I love it. And then, like, further down the track, there's another moment I just want to play a fill that happens. It's just beautiful, kind of the same language. But it just all feels so great. And it's just inspiring, this idea of cats who play sort of a simple language or language that's not mind-blowing, but the feel behind it is so amazing, you know. And what makes like an Ed Green, you know, 100 guys could sit and play this feel, and what's happening, you know, with Ed, like the velocity of the, how loud the balance of the kit, the ghost notes. I was reading an interview that, you know, he was a huge fan of Benny Benjamin, one of the great Motown drummers, him and Pistol Allen and those guys. And, you know, the fills like, you know, all those great Motown fills. And he said he would sit before he do a track. It's like, well, what would Benny Benjamin do, you know? And so, and he was using the words like, Bob McAdoo, you know, and pachyderm, which I guess is an elephant, pachyderm. And so there's this track in this interview I was hearing where it's a classic track from the Asia record, I've Got the News. And, you know, so many great, obviously, legendary record. And Ed's on this track. And let's listen to a second. You'll hear the fill, that kind of fill language, the Benny Benjamin Motown thing, integrated into this whole track as almost part of the, as part of the beat. Feel of that is just insane to me. It's just crazy how great that is. And I think in this interview they mentioned that maybe the engineer went through and counted, like there were 64 versions of him using that kind of Benny Benjamin language, you know, within the whole track and the groove. But man, just these drummers that have the ability to make the wall sweat with their feel, where it's just so exciting and instantly you have to be moving. It's always been such a magnet for me to I just love it, you know. So I, you know, I wanted to just talk about some of those. I can't play examples of all these guys, but Al Jackson with Stax. And then he's also, I was lucky my mother had those Al Green records when I was growing up. And him and Howard Grimes are on a lot of that Al Green stuff. Jim Gordon is another name from this era that is on so much stuff and just an insane feel. Rick Marotta, who's on the Asia record, obviously with Peg, and Beccaro, James Gadsden, the drummers of James Brown, Clive Stubblefield, those guys. I love Phil Rudd with AC/DC, the way he just charge. And commits this simple thing that's so fat and big and everything that falls around it, you know. I remember there was this producer talking about, he was talking about Mickey Curry and how great Mickey Curry was because there was space around what he played for all the other stuff to sit in, you know, which I thought was a really interesting perspective. As drummers, a lot of times we don't hear a lot of times we're, you know, perspective is drummer based as opposed to what's on the other side of the glass and what they're looking for, you know. So all these guys are heroes. I know, I think there's a photo, I've been able to meet and play and hang with some of these guys. I think there's a photo, well, maybe of Earl Palmer, getting to meet him. And it was a big dinner that we had in New York with drummers. And just the legacy of these guys, the recorded stuff that they've done, and the history of it all, groove-wise, it's just insane. I was lucky enough to get to play with Levon Helm and work at the Midnight Ramble a lot. And he was, there's a photo there, you can see it, the smile. He is such a positive spirit, music-wise, and inclusive. And a lot of drummers got to play with him. And it was really a thrill to be around Levon and just get a sense of how he, his touch on the drums, how he tuned the drums, how the drums were tuned, well, dead. But his touch and his sound, and then because he also sang the way his perspective with the vocals and how he played the drums around his voice. I think there's a shot of when he would play mandolin and we got to play behind him. It's hard to see there, but on the upper left corner, it's him playing mandolin and then, you know, playing drums behind him. That was really a thrill. That whole scene in Woodstock with the Midnight Ramble Band was incredible to be around. I count my blessings about that. And then there's been this thing where I've got to double drum with Steve Gadd for the last 5 years at this show in the Beacon in New York. And it's these big multi-artist shows where, like, you know, Robert Plant, they have all these incredible artists that come in. But, you know, Steve is a master, and to have been lucky enough to be beside him and play with him and learn from, he's one of these guys that you learn so much from just being in the same airspace with, you know, like, incredibly musical. I mean, I know we all know about how great Steve is, but the big picture of how he sees the music and making it all come together as a team, and just his heart, like his pocket and his heart and his feel when he plays, and being around that and actually getting to play with him, I'm so lucky, so fortunate. One of those was it was Steve, and then Steve Jordan was there too, and so those guys are such heroes to me. And to have been 5 feet from them and get to watch them play and play with them, and that's just been incredible inspiration. So let's see, I wanna keep going down the track here. Recently there was a tribute to Charlie Watts, and this record was a huge record for me when I was growing up, you know, when you're in the basement and playing drums. And it was the Black and Blue record, which I guess was 1976. And it's an incredible example of Charlie playing beautiful ballad drums. And this song is, the song is called Memory Motel. And I'm gonna go to where he sort of comes in. It's sort of a transcription of this, which has really been helpful in when I look at someone stylistically, or like, you know, like to actually transcribe the fills and the beats and to get inside what they're doing. So check this beautiful ballad playing out. So this is, so it's wild that first fill when he comes in is just so interesting, because he kind of goes down the drums and then comes back up. But it's also the sound, like the drums are sort of wide open and the way they're tuned in the track, and different for that era when a lot of the drums were like kind of muted down and stuff. So the wide open, like kind of Gretsch toms and stuff. But check out this first fill. just the way it all kind of lays, and then the way he made the choice of, you know, blah, dash, doom, 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 and came back up. It seems so beautiful to me. So I'm going to go to another section of this, and just the fill choices and the way they all fill, just it kills me every time. She drove a pickup truck, painted green and blue. The tires were wearing thin, she turned my eyes. I am a thug, where she had it from. Back up the Boston, I'm singing in a bar. Anyway, just the way everything feels, and again, it's wild. It's not like the language that's being used is, it's interesting about drums in the context of all this, because a lot of the beats and stuff is like language we all learn when you first start playing, you know, but the sound and the feel, and then the way it sort of, his feel approach to it too, you know, sort of before the whole click thing, and it's just beautiful playing, and it kills me every time I hear it. I got to meet Charlie before he passed away, which was really cool. There was this Chuck LaValle, the keyboard player that plays with the Stones, had done a big band record, and so while they were touring, while they were off, he wanted to do a gig in New York. And so, you know, we're all excited to play with Chuck. And then Charlie Watts ends up coming down. And I think there's a couple photos there from, so Charlie came and then he sat in on one of the tunes. And man, he was just such a nice, positive, you know, supportive cat. And it was amazing to see him play up close and his touch on the drums. And at the end of the night, it was a great moment where we got to hug, and I just said, hey man, please know what an inspiration you've been to so many of us, you know, with the parts and the language that you brought to the drums, how important those records are to so many of us, you know. And he's really gracious. And I felt so cool to be able to, you know, to get to say something like that to, one of our heroes and stuff. So we miss Charlie, absolutely. So I want to keep moving, and the next inspiration that just slays me every time I hear him is Bernard Purdy. And man, I was lucky to be hired to play on this Aretha movie that Jennifer Hudson's on. And it was a really cool deep dive into that 60s and early 70s period of Aretha's music. And so this track I want to look at is Spanish Harlem, Aretha's version of Spanish Harlem. And there you see, that's a copy of the chart from the actual session. And like there's a little custom color coded stuff, like the green that's there, that symbolizes the bridge and going to the bell. And it helps me, you know, when looking at a chart, if I can carve up what's happening, anything I can do to give me a break away from the music, away from the actually reading the music and then making the music. So, man, let's take a listen to Bernard on this. just love the way this hi-hat on the end of four is like a hook from the beginning of the song. It starts the song off and then he commits to it. And this fill, the attitude of it, the sound, sounds like maybe toms with the bottom heads off, not sure, kind of muffled down. But this open hi-hat on the end of four, and then just how insane it feels. So good to me. Ow! Moment right there, like you know, like these fills that we all sort of learn, you know, when we first start playing, but the magic behind it feel wise it's just so perfect to me how he can, you know, make something so straight ahead sound so amazing. And then that commitment to the hi-hat on the end of four and this cross-stick quarter note thing, it feels so good. I want to go now to the bridge and let's just check out what happens through the bridge section real quick. So I know this chart probably thing is not super easy to see, but kind of a fill here. And then it goes to the bell and that's when I try to let myself know, okay, you got to make a change here. And there's also a left-hand thing happening with the floor tom that he adds. But it just feels so great to me. It kills me every time I hear it. So, you know, Bernard's one of these guys, he lives in town and you can still go and see him play. One of the amazing things about living in New York is that the chance to actually sit at a table that's very close to the drums and hear how people play the room dynamically, volume wise, and their touch. And, you know, with all the jazz greats too, the opportunities for seeing, you know, your heroes play are there. And Bernard still plays sometimes. And man, I've been lucky enough. I was hired to play with him for his 65th birthday party. And I think there might be a photo of us playing there. So Bernard's on the right with the cowboy hat, and then that's Pancho Morales on congas, who's a legendary conga player. So, I mean, those two guys were in King Curtis's rhythm section, you know, at the Aretha Live at the Fillmore record, you know. I got to play with these guys. It just killed me. It was such an incredible day. Will Lee was on bass, and Steve Cropper was there, I believe. He came in from Stax, and he has some incredible Al Jackson stories. Talks about how Al Jackson used the floor tom mostly as sort of an ashtray, and maybe there were a couple of cigarette burns on the head, but didn't really change any heads until one broke and stuff. And so he was there. This is an incredible day. I love Bernard Purdy so much, and every time I've seen him play, it's been just an incredible inspiration. So The next guy that was part of, you know, the Aretha movie thing was a deep dive into the songs that Roger Hawkins played on. And it's wild, you know, with this screenshot here, like there's so many classic tunes, Never Looked a Man, Chain of Fools, Think, Respect, Do Right Woman, Dr. Feel Good, and on, you know. And Roger's discography is another one of those guys at Muscle Shoals, you know, they made so many great records. And working over at Saturday Night Live, you know, a lot of the language of that is kind of based on that kind of groove R&B stuff, you know, from Stax and Muscle Shoals. And also Lenny Pickett runs the band now, and, you know, he was in Tower of Power. So, you know, the legacy of David Garibaldi, which is incredibly inspired, you know. So this Muscle Shoals Stax kind of like lineage thing, you know, is kind of a part of that gig, trying to be in touch with all that, and emphasis on the feel, and maybe simple language, but trying to blow it up feel-wise, you know. So those tracks and getting a chance to do a deep dive into Roger Hawkins and his legacy, I've always been a fan. And I picked out a couple tunes that are Kill Me, that Roger played on. This first one is a song called If You're Ready, and it's a Staple Singer song. It's from 73, and it's sort of a follow-up to the smash they had in 1972 with I'll Take You There. So let's just listen to a little bit of this, because this feel is insane. How the cat come up with a part like, you know, sort of this New Orleans-y snare drum thing, and then bar four is just eighth notes, but it's just perfect. You know, we're gonna party, let's do this, you know. Picture that's happening there, it just kills me. I want to go to the sort of the ride out and listen to some of the fills and things he does. Such classic drumming, man. Roger Hawkins, you know, and it just, everything feels amazing. It's amazing. You know, and it's like, I don't even know how to put it into words. It kills me, but can't talk about it. Don't know how. but I sure do love it. I sure do love it. Oh my God. So, you know, speaking of Roger, I love him so much. I think this is before I got to hang with him. He came to New York once, and because of this cross stick sound on I'll Take You There and all this stuff, like I made him sign this cross stick attachment because the records where he played all that cross stick stuff was so hip and inspiring. And so he signed that. This is a wonderful snare, a DW rolled brass, a three millimeter share, the shell, the thinner shell, brings a lot of cool warmth to it and stuff. It's a beautiful drum. And then the fact that Roger signed this little cross stick thing, you know, every time I get to play a cross stick, I always think of him, you know, those parts that he came up with. So this last example of that is Roger playing on a big hit for Paul Simon. This was, I think, May of 73. It went to number two. And I feel like it's just an incredible textbook example of arranging a part for a track. And he saves the entrance of the snare drum until the reintro after the first chorus. And, you know, and like when he decides to, he comments on spaces in the lyric with little accents and stuff. There's a fill he does that consistently sort of starts on the end of three. So just the way the snare comes in on the end of three, like an eighth note before the backbeat, the way it sort of throws you into the next section is really beautiful. And there's an overdub on this. And I was reading about the track. It's really cool. They took a 2-inch tape box, which I guess are the old, you know, like when they had tape machines when they made records. I guess 2-inch tapes, some big kind of Ampeg, you know, boxes. And he played with hard vibe mallets on this box. And then in the interview, he was talking about how he kept adjusting the muffling that was in the box to make sure, because it wasn't cutting the right way, like sonically, you know. And I thought it was just so interesting about that part of like the making records and the creativity of that era. Well, all the cats, you know, anybody that's working a lot, probably they bring that to the table, you know. To have an open mind about sound and parts. And I remember Roy Haley, who was the great engineer with a lot of the Simon and Garfunkel records. And he talked about Hal Blaine on, maybe it was Bridge Over Troubled Water, but one of the backbeat sounds. And Hal actually taking his car back to his garage and bringing back a tire chain so that he could sort of slam it on the floor of the studio and they could mic that, and it sort of had the sound with the backbeat, you know, that was like a big, big sound. But this creativity and openness, you know, about parts. And so this overdub you'll hear is kind of a constant gallop with an Ampeg tape box. And anyway, let's listen to a little bit of this. This track is insane. Saved the snare drum for this reintro after the first chorus. Like he didn't he didn't go to the snare drum on the chorus. Like, so he saved, you know, this idea of like, again, when coming up with parts, like when do you bring in the snare, or when do you use a cymbal, or you stay tight on the hi-hat until like a solo section, or, and the choices that he makes are so cool. You know, like when it's the first time we hear the snare, is this reintro after the first chorus. He didn't give it away in the first chorus. Consistently, and four, and like that's happened, you know, in the first verses and now this verse two. So it becomes the fabric of the tune and a hook, you know, within the context of the whole drum part. It's not like an arbitrary thing. It's something that he's like consciously doing, and it's just so badass, and it doesn't get in the way, and I just love it. And it's not like there's a big crash after it, because you know the vocal's still there, so it's happening, and the loping of the overdub is still happening continuously on the tape box. So the whole conglomerate and big picture of this thing just is so genius to me. And we're still on cross stick. We're in second chorus, and he's gonna stay on the cross stick. But then when we release to the snare, there'll be a lift. Every time, I think every two or four bars there was just da 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 da, the chrome away, da da. You know, and so like straight ahead language, but the way it fits into the whole thing with the vocal and the phrasing, and it just feels so insane. And then the overdub with the loping tape box, and gives me the heebie-jeebies. How great it is. Ah! My God. Well, it's interesting. Roger just passed away, and they had an obituary, and there's a quote that I thought was really beautiful. It sort of sums up his approach, you know, session work. It says up here, you know, a lot of times he would use a lot of space and wait for the right time to make his move, and then talking about studio players, and sometimes they feel a pressure that they've got to, you know, play something fast and get hired again. But the way this quote ends is so fascinating to me. It says, that's not the way to go. I've always said this. I was always a better listener than I was a drummer. And I would advise any drummer to become a listener, you know. And I feel that so much when I hear this track, like the way the moves he makes, and comments in between the lyrical the lyrical stuff and how he orchestrates his part and how it makes the whole track lift and come back down and lift and all great session musicians sort of have an instinct for that kind of stuff and realize how important it is, you know. So you guys, this was really an honor for me to get to come and hang, and thanks to Jules at DW for inviting me to be on the playlist party. And anyway, all right, keep on grooving and stay safe out there. Crazy times. All right, thank you, thank you, thank you.